Well, good evening.
Good evening.
It's a wonderful day. Parts of it were wonderful. Like when the sun came out after the rain, that was wonderful. We need the rain, don't we? We are in lesson three of our workbook, still in Hosea, and this lesson covers chapters 8 through 10. Did kind of a review there Sunday morning before we got into our lesson. We talked about the time frame of this book being written or taking place in 753 to 715 BC, somewhere in that ballpark. The northern tribe of Israel was under Jeroboam while Hosea was writing part of this. And if you want to get kind of the historical background of this time and place, you can reference 2 Kings about chapter 14 to get that perspective. To give you a little bit more background, you know, Israel this time was under a great economic boom. It's one of the most prosperous times in their history. Times are good, and it seems like the better the times are, the further away from God they get. And they are worshiping idols again. There's shifting alliances between the Assyrians and Egypt. And all the time that they're doing these things that God does not like, they're feeling that God is blessing them, because they are so prosperous at this time. But as we find out, as we go through the lesson of Isaiah, things are about to change. Another thing I mentioned Sunday morning, I've heard Hosea referred to as a tragic love story with a happy ending. You know, there's tragedy coming, and God's pleading with his people to change their ways before their punishment comes. And he also uses Hosea in his life as a parallel to what's going to happen to the Israelites. Let's go ahead and go into the lesson. We were talking in lesson three, and just like I said, it covers chapters 8 through 10. And I read through all three of those chapters Sunday morning. And now we have the questions out of our workbook, and I thought we'd go through those this evening. It pretty much goes along with the questions that we have, or the chapters as they go. And I'll start with the first one. What hidden treasure did you find in your reading of this? I didn't read the whole question there, but it says Proverbs 2, chapters 1 through 5 tells about a sincere person who truly longs for wisdom and understanding and searches the scriptures, for it is as if there were treasure buried there. Such a person, this passage says, will come to understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. As you continue to explore the book of Hosea, what hidden treasure would you like God to help you find here to show you what God's wisdom are really like? If you have this desire, how would you express in your own words of prayer to God? My question simply is, what hidden treasure did you find when you was reading this book? I can tell you what I give you some of the things that I found. When we were reading, especially in lessons 1 and 2, Hosea, I saw God's emotion, probably not like I've seen before. Through Hosea, God is showing his emotion, his pain. We're seeing that side of him that, you know, every time we transgress from his word, it hurts. I think oftentimes we see that God is portrays this being that's sent up above, and you'll obey me and do what I say, and if not, you're going to suffer the punishment. But it's not like that, is it? He's a loving God, cares for his people, and wants them to obey, but he's not, you know, the punishment's coming if you don't obey, but he wants to give you every opportunity to do that. You know, like I said, I've seen how much we hurt him when we sin. In the writings of Hosea, pleading with the Israelites, you know, there's so many things that they did that hurt God.
Especially considering the fact of how direct of an impact God had on their history. We haven't seen the seas part. We haven't seen a mountain on fire. We haven't heard God speak as the Israelites did. And so, you know, they had direct knowledge. Like we live by faith. We have faith that mountain is on fire. We have faith that the sea is part of it. But they saw it. It wasn't faith. It was just history.
If their generation didn't see it, they were only a couple of generations removed.
Yeah, but their grandparents saw it. Or their great-grandparents.
It's not like me being born in the mid-60s and hearing my grandfather talk about World War II, that era. You know, mm-hmm. My great-uncle fought in World War II, and the stories that he told about that, you know, you can relate to that. You can get a picture of it. You see the war movies on TV, and you kind of picture this and that. Yeah, they were closer to it than what we are as far as time removed.
And as far as, you know, just God's physical hands on them, basically. And I honestly think there are times when I think we have better faith than they did. It's hard to say, you know, hard to be judgmental about that. But,
yeah.
But, you know, we have, my grandfather didn't tell me stories of going up on the mountain and eating dinner in the presence of God.
Right.
You know, their great-grandfathers went up on the mountain and God was there. And they ate dinner. I don't fully understand where God was in this, but, you know, they saw him, they saw what he was standing, you know, because I think some Bibles would call it sapphire, others would call it lapis lazuli, which is like a sapphire with gold streaks or something like that. But you know, I mean, like, God invited him to dinner, and they lost the scrolls. And, you know, from the story, we know they lost the Bible. Like they didn't have one. Finally, the king couldn't sleep, and he woke up and wandered around and found it. I mean,
you know, we like you said, we have a luxury of being, and whether we have more faith or not, we get to read about all their faults. They're under a microscope as far as we're concerned. And you know, we think about, well, how could they turn their back on God? But then again, we see it every day.
Oh.
And it's not that much different than what they did. It may be different in a sense. You know, I don't see a whole lot of Bible worshiping people out there. But we have a room set of idols in worship. And sometimes they take the place of putting God first. They actually worshiped idols. They worshiped to that, they incorporated it into their worship of God. Anybody else have any hidden treasures that they see, you think they find after they've read Hosea? One more comparison there. And I think we've talked about this when we were in the story. But, I look at how I compare God to a parent, compared to me as a parent. And if my son or my daughter did some of these things that I would desire them not to do, how hurtful that would be. And it's kind of similar. That's I had three, that's all. If nothing further on that, we can go to question two. It says, summarize the ways in which Israel's hypocrisy and apostasy are exposed in Hosea chapter 8. The hypocrisy and apostasy. And definition of apostasy would be an abandonment of their faith, abandonment or a regression or a renunciation of their faith or religious beliefs. We all know what hypocrisy is. It's putting on airs and acting like you're doing the right thing and you're not asking for it. I have chapter 8, verse 2. Says, Israel cries out to me, our God, we acknowledge you. What are they, is he actually acknowledging them for what they're doing at this point in time? That would be an act of hypocrisy on their behalf. You get one to read verse 3, it says that Israel is rejected what is good, and then we will pursue it. In verse 4, it says, they set up kings without my consent, make idols for themselves to their own destruction. That would be apostasy. Verse 5, it says, Samaria, throw out your calf idol. My anger burns against them. How long will they be incapable of purity? So the calf idol, the apostasy. Verse 9. For they've gone to Assyria like a wild donkey, wandering alone. Ephraim has sold herself to lovers. And that sold herself to lovers, they sold themselves to Samaria. Verse 11, it says, though Ephraim built many altars for sin offerings, they had become altars for sinning. Hypocrisy. You're being hypocritical, aren't you? Saying you're worshiping God, you're actually worshiping these idols.
You know, they're going to Syria for their protection as opposed to going to God for their protection. And once again, we're just a couple generations from Jericho.
Yeah. How soon do they forget? And they're even dealing with the Egyptians. They're dealing with the, you know, we read of those two, the Assyrians and the Egyptians. How many other nations? They were out there brokering deals. You know, they were very wealthy at this point in time. It's probably the richest they've been since Saul. And they're out there brokering these deals, playing these countries against each other. And, you know, even if God wasn't involved for their destruction, sooner or later, they'd probably come back to bite them.
You run out of them.
Yeah. They built many altars. elders that I've read this, they built many altars for sin offerings. And those, you know, they built these altars for God. And then what they did, they actually sinned using it. Says, I wrote many things of my law, they regarded as something forward. That's an apostasy. They've regressed, or they've renunciated. They didn't even acknowledge the Ten Commandments that God had put down. Offers, in verse 13, offer sacrifices as gifts to me, and though they eat meat, the Lord is not pleased with them. That's hypocrisy. That's all I have for chapter 8. Anybody else have anything? If not, let's go on to question 3. It says, note the question that is asked in the final line of Hosea 8, verse 5. What do you see as the best answer to that question? And the question that God posed was, how long will they be incapable purity? What's the short-term answer? How long will they be incapable of purity? What time frame are we in this? What's Hosea prophesying is going to happen, and how soon will that happen? What's Hosea prophesying? He's prophesying to the Israelites for what? Their city's going to be destroyed and they're going into captivity. It's not very far away, a few years. That's the short-term answer. And then God poses a question, you know, how long will it be before they are incapable of purity? How long are they going to remain this way? How long is their attitude going to stay this way for them to keep sinning? So my short-term answer is, it's going to be a little over 70-plus years, right?
Yes.
They're in captivity for 70-some years. Now, my long-term answer is 700-plus years. Because if we're about 750 or 715, when we get to the time of Christ, they may not be worshiping idols, but they are very caught up in some other things that are going on with the Old Testament law. And they also crucified my son. Go ahead.
After the Babylonian captivity,
mm-hmm.
When was the next time Israel was in?
After the Babylonian captivity, it was 70 plus years that they were in captivity, then they went back to Jerusalem, right?
Right.
And who helped them rebuild Jerusalem? They were under what? It wasn't the Babylonians, it was...
Yeah, it was the Babylonians.
Well, or was it the Babylonians?
Yeah, because they gave them, or was it the Persians?
Wow.
Because the Persians, Daniel's, you know, when the finger wrote on the wall,
uh-huh.
Daniel interpreted, that was the night the Persians came in.
Okay.
So the Persians gave them some of the gold from the temple.
Yeah, and let Daniel go to there.
Yeah. But then I have read things that said they were never a country again until after World War II.
Yeah, nothing like
an independent
Yeah, nothing like they were. I mean, when Jerusalem is destroyed and they get overtaken,
yeah,
and they get, you know, exiled, they will never have an army like they had here. They'll never be a power like they were here. But they end up being a people that settle in a region that they have before. The city of Jerusalem gets rebuilt. But then again, you know,
but they're always under occupation.
Yes. And during Christ's time, it's the Romans.
And I'm wondering if what I read was true, that it wasn't until the UN instituted them that was the next time they were, that they ruled themselves, basically, that they weren't under occupation, they weren't living in somebody else's land.
Yeah. Well, they got dispersed throughout the world, you know, probably more during Roman rule, after Roman rule, after the time of Christ. She wants me to say something. But, you know, Israel is a nation, that, was that 1953 that that happened?
48, I think.
48.
Yeah.
May 14, 1948.
But, you know, they weren't the nation like Israel was a nation back then, with the 12 tribes, or 11 tribes, but, 11 or 10. In the northern section of Judah. But regardless, they weren't what they were back then. Not the purity that they had as far as the different tribes and all that. I read someplace that they even have a very tough time tracing their lineage back when they got back so far. What was the question?
Well, how long their purity? And
yeah. Well, their purity, they, you know, he exiled them for 7 years. And then they rebuilt the city of Jerusalem. And, you know, they settled there. And then they started worshiping God again. So they came back to God. So the first answer would be 70 years. And then how many years after that, you know? The time of Christ, you know, they were straying away from God's rule again, doing different things. Not idol worship or change. They were doing other things, you know.
Just sort of ceremonial words.
Ceremony. That was the word I was looking for earlier. Yeah. I have here where it was mostly hypocrisy. Very hypocritical. About question 4, it says in chapter 8, verses 13 through 14, what significance do you see in the punishment God promised toward his people? Anybody want to read chapter 8, verses 13 and 14?
For the sacrifices of my offerings, they sacrifice flesh and eat it. But the Lord does not accept them. Now he will remember their iniquity and punish their sins. They shall return to Egypt. For Israel has forgotten his maker and has built temples. Judah also has multiplied fortified cities. But I will send fire upon his cities, and it shall devour his palaces.
Says a lot there, doesn't it? First thing is, where are they going to go back to? Egypt. What happened the last time they were in Egypt?
Slaves.
Yeah. So it's kind of a return to hard times, isn't it? They don't have a whole lot of good memories about being in Egypt.
They want to keep
They keep regressing, don't they? He says, I will send fire on their cities that will consume their fortresses, their palaces. And that's kind of talking about the time that they're in, the wealth that they have. They've built these giant palaces, and they, you know, they're wealthy, but God says, that's just going to go away. That will be destroyed. And the end result is of this, they'll lose everything. And it will be apocalyptic. It will be a very, very brutal thing that they're going to have to go through. Number five, what are God's people warned about? Hosea 9, verses 1 through 9. And what is the significance of these warnings? So would somebody like to read chapter 9, verses 1 through 9?
Do not rejoice, O Israel. Rejoice like other peoples. For you have played the harlot against your God. You have made love for her on every threshing floor. The threshing floor and the winepress shall not feed them, and the new wine shall fail her. They shall not dwell in the Lord's land, but Ephraim shall return to Egypt and shall eat unclean things in Assyria. They shall not offer wine offerings to the Lord. They shall not sacrifice and be pleasing to him. It shall be like the bread of mourners to them. All who eat shall not be defiled, for the bread shall be for their own life. It shall come in the house of the Lord. What will you do in the appointed day, and in the day of the feast of the Lord? For indeed they are gone because of destruction. Egypt shall gather them up. Memphis shall bury them. Nettles shall possess their valuables of silver. Thorns shall be in their tents. The day of the punishment has come. The day of recompense has come. Israel knows. The prophet is a fool. The spiritual man is insane. Because of the greatness of your iniquity and great enmity, the watchman of Ephraim is with my God. But the prophet is a fowler's snare in all his ways, enmity in the house of God. They shall be deeply corrupted, as in the days of Gibeah. He will remember their iniquity, he will punish their sins.
Thank you, King. Question asked, what's the significance of these warnings that Gene just read? God tells them, says, don't rejoice, don't be jubilant like other nations. Says that in verse 1. Says the new wine will not feed the people. I have any idea what that statement might be.
New wine is not very good.
It says threshing floors and wine presses will not feed the people. The new wine will fail them. I think what I take from it is, and there's several statements, several verses, you know, they're living in this wealth of time, but the high times are going to be coming to an end very shortly. Some of, like, verse 4, the latter part says, sacrifices will be to them like bread of mourners. All who will eat them will be unclean. This food will be for themselves and will not come to the temple of the Lord. He's basically telling them they're not going to be in Jerusalem anymore. They're not going to be in this northern country anymore. You know, they had appointed places to worship God. They're not going to be able to do that now. They had a time and place for these festivals. They're not going to be able to do that anymore. They're going to be under oppression. They're going to be in another land. And, you know, and he goes, the Lord goes on to say they're not going to be in his land. Their sacrifice is not pleasing. The day of reckoning is at hand. Its time is coming close. And God will remember their wickedness and punish them for their sins. Question 6. God's warnings in chapter 9, verses 10 through 17. Anybody want to read that? Chapter 9, verses 10 through 17.
When I found Israel, it was like finding grapes in the desert. When I saw your ancestors, it was like seeing the early fruit on the fig tree. But when they came to Baal Peor, they consecrated themselves to that shameful idol and became as vile as the thing they loved. Ephraim's glory will fly away like a bird. No birth, no pregnancy, no conception. Even if they rear children, I will bereave them of every one. Woe to them. When I turn away from them, I have seen Ephraim like Tyre, planted in a pleasant place. But Ephraim will bring out their children to the slayer. Give them, Lord, what will you give them? Give them wombs that miscarry and breasts that are dry because of all their wickedness in Gilgal. I hated them there because of their shameful deeds. I will drive them out of my house. I will no longer love them. All their leaders are rebellious. Ephraim is blighted. Their root is withered. They yield no fruit. Even if they bear children, I will slay their cherished offspring. My God will reject them because they have not obeyed him. They will be wanderers among the nations.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow. Sounds to me like, first of all, they're not going to be able to conceive or have children. God's not going to stop for that for a period of time. And if they do, they're going to be taken from them. And even the last part of that, what you read there, Frank, I will slay and cherished offspring. So, I mean, so, you know, it's God's very upset with his people right now. Go ahead.
The statement, I will love them, I will no longer love them. I mean, that's pretty harsh.
Yeah.
And the fact that they won't be able to have children, I don't know, it kind of dawned on me that especially in those times, I would assume that your children took care of you when you were no longer able to take care of yourself. So as you grow into your old age and you need the help of your children, they won't be there. I mean, that's a kind of lonely future. You know, I mean, when you look at that and you think about it.
Well, think about this. I mean, how many of them are going to be killed when they're ever Syrians, when Jerusalem falls, when the nation falls, how many of them are going to be killed and killed brutally? Then what's left over, whoever that is, gets taken away to Egypt, captivity. Then God says, you know, you're not going to reproduce for a while. You know, and this is a period of time. We know that they were in captivity for 70 plus years from here.
Yeah.
That's how many generations? 3.5 generations if you base a generation on 20 years? Pretty powerful right there. Of course, we're running out of time, so. Just want to see if there was anything else. The questions are pretty, and I think the questions in this part are pretty good questions. There's just a lot of material here in 3 chapters. Yeah, 3 chapters. But I think we can get the big picture, can't we? What's going to happen? I think the latter part of chapter 10, though, where's that chapter 8, verse 10? When it talks about chapter 9, verse 7. The days of punishment are coming, the days of reckoning are at hand. Let Israel know this, because your sins are so many and your hostility so great, the prophet is considered a fool. Hosea. And the inspired person, the maniac. Yeah, and there were many other prophets about this period of time. And they were scorned and they weren't listened to. They weren't heeded. Then they were outright hostile sometimes. I just thought that interesting. The prophet, along with my God, is the watchman over Ephraim, yet snares awaiting on all his paths and hostility in the house of his God. Hosea's trying to warn them, they're not heeding. He even lived his life as an example that God wanted him to see the comparison of what would happen to him because of the prostitution that they were living in at that time. If you get a chance, go ahead and go through the rest of the questions, and we will start lesson 4 Sunday morning. Thank you all for your participation. Anybody have any questions or comments about what we discussed?